Hey everybody, it's Jennifer J. Welcome back. This is episode 76 and I am coming to you from Kansas. I'm at my daughter's house right now and we are going to talk about our T.D. Jakes sermon, naturally, from last July, Blind to the Bread. And it's out of Mark chapter 8 through 14 through 22. I didn't bring my hard copy Bible with me to Kansas. Traveling, I just have so many things in my bag and it's always just like right at the 50 pound mark. So I did take it out, and because I have my Bible app on my phone, right? And I use that. So I don't have it. So I'm not gonna read it to you because I'm using my phone to record. So I can't use it to get into the Bible app, but you can read Mark 8, 14 through 22. And that is what the sermon Blind to the Bread was based off of for this sermon by T.D. Jakes. It was from July 17th of 2022, if you want to look it up. And I'm kind of just going to go over parts of it because you know his sermons are always really long. I feel like I need a pillow behind my back. Sorry if I look a little scrunched. But yeah, it's really long, so we'll just go over parts of this. But I wanted to bring out some things that were really good. At least to me, so I hope they are to you as well. He said, first of all, Jesus was having a private discussion about a public miracle, and it's about the disciples had left the bread in the boat. They had forgotten the bread, and Jesus tells them to beware of the yeast of the Pharisees, and they're discussing amongst themselves, what is he talking about? Like, he's saying that because we forgot the bread, or like, where does he expect us to find this bread, or something like that. And so they're having this discussion, and he is aware of their discussion. And first of all, we all know that he's aware, right? But we need to be aware. It's gonna sound funny, but we need to be aware that he's aware, because whatever discussion we're having, he's aware of it. So we need to be careful what we're talking about. Anyway, so that was one thing, but then as he's talking about that, he was saying, Jesus asked them, don't you remember? Don't you, like, why are you worrying about bread? Like physical, like a loaf of bread. Why are you worrying about that? Don't you remember the miracle of when we had two loaves and two fish or five fish and whatever it was, two fish and five loaves, that's what it was. And we fed all those people. Like, why are you worrying about bread right now? Like, he's just like, hello. But T.D. Jakes said, he doesn't create in darkness. The first thing God created was light. He created light first. And we need to believe in the light. And in the light is how God creates. And so that's an important thing to remember, that he creates in the light. And he said that we have five senses, physical senses, you know, touch and hearing and vision and taste and smell. So we have five physical senses, but we have spiritual senses too. So we have eyesight, but we also have insight. And he said the entrance of God's word gives light. So when you're reading the Bible, or when you're listening to a sermon or a podcast or whatever that's using scripture, the entrance of God's word gives light. So there's no darkness in Jesus at all. And I don't know if some of you have probably done this, but you know, if you know how you hold something up to a light bulb or whatever, and there'll be a shadow, right? Well, obviously if this is the light bulb, the shadow's over here. But if you hold up a lighter and light the lighter, or a candle that's lit, the flame doesn't have a shadow because there's no darkness in light. And so that's always a fun thing to do with kids and show them that there's no shadow, right? But it's good for us to remember too that in Jesus there is no darkness. And everything grows in light too, right? So probably in fifth grade science class, you all did put the plant in the closet and put the other plant by the window or whatever and see which one grows. And like science projects, I can remember doing those. And the one in the closet doesn't grow, right? It needs the light. And so things grow in light, and we need to be in the light of Jesus in order to grow spiritually. And so the enemy will bring dark people into your life to stop your growth. Not everybody that comes into your life is for your benefit. Dark people will come into your life to stunt your growth or to stop your growth. And obviously God can turn it to good, but we need to be diligent in who we're spending our time with, and being aware of the people around us. So know what is the hope of your calling. He said, one touch from Jesus can change your life. And that's true, right? I mean, when you prayed to be saved, one touch from Jesus, you said a prayer and he saved you. I think of the woman with the issue of blood, and you know, she just touched the hem of his garment and she was healed. But one touch from Jesus can change your life. Miracles and signs were done so that they might believe one word from Jesus. He performed miracles. That got their attention, right? Because then they believed. And darkness comes in the form of doubt, insecurity, intimidation, fear. But he can perform miracles and show himself mighty in all of those situations. But when you're feeling those things, those are normal feelings to have. And at some point in our life, we all feel them. But as a Christian, you have to remember where those are coming from. Those aren't of God. He doesn't want you to have those. He wants you to replace those negative thoughts and take them captive and replace them with truth. And truth is Jesus. And so every characteristic of Jesus would be truth. So you say to yourself, he is almighty. He is the only God. He is omnipresent. He is supreme. He is all powerful. He loves me. He cares about me. All the different things that you could say about Jesus. And I think I've told you this before, but you can go, especially if you're new to the faith, new to growing in your faith, you can go on the computer or your phone or whatever and just do a search in the search bar for characteristics of Jesus. And you can print them out or screenshot them or whatever and have them at the ready. When doubt or insecurity or intimidation or fear creeps in, you can go to that list and you can just start naming them off, the names of God or the characteristics of God, and just start saying them out loud to yourself. First of all, you'll learn them. But second of all, it helps you to get rid of those feelings right away, to replace those thoughts right away. So that's a great way to do that if you don't know what they are. But he then says, how are we accounting for the stewardship of miracles? And are you prepared for what God will do because of what he has done? So we know all the miracles God's created, or God's performed, right? We know all the miracles of Jesus from the Bible. Now, he wasn't just a miracle performing God in Bible times. He still performs miracles today. And you have to be prepared for how he's going to do that in your life. And not only how he's going to do that, but how you're going to then use that to share the gospel. Because that's our job, right? When he called us to be his disciples, he called us and he commissioned us to go and tell other people. We're not supposed to keep it to ourselves. We're not supposed to fit into the world and don't rock the boat and don't offend anybody. Like, no, he said, come out from them and be different. Go tell people about me. Don't be ashamed of me. Don't be embarrassed of me. Be proud of me and go tell people about me so that they can join and be saved and tell other people about me. So we need to be prepared for that, and we need to think about all the miracles he's done and how powerful he really is. And then we need to remember that he resides in us. He sent the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit is not a lesser God. The Holy Spirit is part of the Trinity. There's the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He is just as powerful and just as much God as the other two. And so he's living in us. And so you have the power of God living inside of you. And you need to be ready for how he plans to use that in your life. So he said, when we get back to the bread, he had more bread. This time they had 7 loaves that they had left in the boat, right? So the last time they had, I'm going to say it wrong again, 2 loaves and 5 fish, 2 fish and 5 loaves. I think it was that way. This time they had 7 loaves. They had fewer people, and there was less leftovers. So think about that. So they had more bread that he blessed, and they didn't have as many people to feed, but they had fewer leftovers than the time before. And what he said is, there was a different appetite. It was a different congregation. They weren't as hungry. And he said, how hungry are you, and have you forgotten about the bread? He said, don't let hell trick you into forgetting. Because that's what Satan does, right? He brings darkness. So he said, he had told the disciples to go, and there was no plan B. He said, go. Don't take an extra money bag. Don't take extra shoes. Like, just go. And I wanted to read what I had written in my notes there, but that's, I don't want to go down that rabbit hole. So, but he told them to go, and they trusted him. And so, you know, trust is my word for 2023. And so I just love that I think everyone I've done, every recording I've made so far this year has come back to that word, trust. And it's just reiterating to me in my spirit to trust God. Not everything is going like I would like it to in my life. There are things I've been praying about that I'm not getting answers to, at least not the answers I want. And I'm just being constantly reminded to trust God, trust his timing, trust his faithfulness, trust his wisdom, because he knows, he sees the end of the road. He's already been there, and I'm not there yet. So I just need to trust that he knows what he's doing. So he also was talking about that in Genesis, there was light and there was darkness because God created boundaries, right? And I think I've talked about that before too. He divided the firmament, the water up below from the heavens above. Again, boundaries. And boundaries are okay, and they're even necessary, but there's a line that marks the limit of an activity. So we have to set limits. We have to set boundaries. We have to know what we believe and why we believe it. And there are boundaries that God has created for our best interest that we need to obey. And it's not so that we're not happy, or, you know, a lot of people say, well, you only live once, you know, whatever, YOLO. But while that may be true, we only have one physical life on this earth. God doesn't say, so therefore just go and be happy because it's all about you being happy. No, he says, go and glorify me. And that doesn't always mean, that doesn't always equal being happy life. I mean, Paul was in prison, right? I don't think that was happy. And yet he was at peace because he was sharing the gospel. And so we have to really set our mind a little different. And not that he wants us to be unhappy here, but that is not his primary concern. Our happiness is not the primary concern. We should have his peace and his joy, and that's a concern, sure. But us having the perfect house or the perfect car or the perfect job or whatever, that's not the point of life. Like, the point of life is to make disciples and give glory to God. That is the whole point. So we need to do that, and we need to look at what boundaries the Bible has set for us in our life, and we need to adhere to those. And it's not easy. I'm not throwing stones. It's not easy. But it is something we have to do, and we have to do it moment by moment. So he had said, for instance, if you have a short fuse, you know, if you get angry really easily, if you can never be wrong, or if you're closed-minded about someone else's narrative, if you have to always be in control, if you're a liar, these are things that need worked on, and we need to work on them within the boundaries of what God says about, you know, being slow to anger and loving others and giving someone not just the shirt off your back, but the tunic too, or the coat too, or whatever. So there are things, and to be truthful and honest and have integrity, he tells us, not to bear false witness. So we need to formulate everything in our life, everything about our life, what we see, what we think, what we hear, what we do, how we spend our time, needs to be within these boundaries that God's created for us. So I hope that makes sense to you guys, and that you're able to think about that and even go and print off that sheet of characteristics like I told you to, or names of God, either one. Names of God is good, and also characteristics is good. They're both going to be a long list. But let me know in the comments if you have done that, because I know I've mentioned it before, or if you're going to do that this time. And then read the story in Mark chapter 8. I'm going to go back and make for sure. Mark chapter 8, verses 14 through 22, about the bread. And I think that'll make more sense to you. I'm sorry that I couldn't read it to you tonight, but you guys have Bibles and you can read that. So next time, surprise, it's another T.D. Jakes sermon. But I will be, let's see, I get home on Saturday. So I'll probably record from Arizona next time for Monday, because I'm really short on time here. I know I missed Mondays this week because I thought I already had it recorded, actually, and I didn't. And then that surprised me. So I'm trying to get this one done for you guys. But it's awesome. God's doing some amazing things. I can't wait to share them with you. I'm not quite ready to share them yet, because God tells me when he's ready for me to share. But he is definitely moving, and there are some big things happening and things that he's having me do in Arizona, and how that's all going to transpire. So you might be getting a letter from me. If you would like a letter from me and you haven't gotten one, you can also put that in the comments, and I will get you one. But I'm going to be doing a monthly newsletter out to everybody. So if you would like to be added to that list, just let me know. And that will explain more on a regular basis what's happening in real time, because I know I'm still about 6 months behind in the YouTubes. And that should be catching up soon too, because I think come October, it goes much faster to get to January. I don't have an every single day thing going on. But some really cool things happening that I would love to tell you about. So stay tuned, and mark in the comments if you want that newsletter, and I will do my best to stay on track and get these to you every Monday and Thursday from here on out for the new year. So keep trusting in him. Bye-bye.